I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Martin, present. Mrs. Ruth, here. Mr. Lasevich.
Present.
Mr. Nola.
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Here.
Mr. Ritter.
Here.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Here.
Mrs. Warning.
Here.
Mr. Williams.
Here.
Thank you, Bonnie. Tonight, before we begin, we have a special presentation. One of our Gateway's newly hired officers, Tony Scalise, had to jump into action as working as one of the officers in the cafeteria last week at the high school. So Tony witnessed a student choking and quickly responded by performing the Heimlich maneuver on Chris Sinclair. So tonight we have a very special guest to present tonight's award to Anthony. So Chris and Anthony, if you guys would mind standing up by the podium there. And Chris would like to present the award on behalf of the entire Gateway School District community.
Thank you.
Thank you
for saving my life.
My pleasure, bud.
Yeah.
Slow down on the
food. Yeah.
Say this was actually a collective effort with Mr. Justice as well. He needs recognized. And Chris having the wherewithal to come find me, and I'm happy to shed a positive light on our team here. Brian and John have done a great job, and that's just I want to put that out there. So
very good.
Thank you very much.
All right. Hard to follow that up for the rest of the meeting, but we will start with comments from residents on agenda items.
No one
sign up in advance. Okay. We have anyone that would like to speak on agenda items? Seeing none at this time, we'll move on to Section B, Bills and Financials. Mr. Sharp.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbort. The financial reports will be presented at the regular board meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Section C, items previously tabled. We do have one, which was a motion to hire a municipality of Monroeville SRO until the school police decision is decided.
Yes.
You want to speak to that?
Sure. The reason that this school board felt the need to hire a school police force was because they felt that an armed officer in every building would equate to a safer school environment. Since the beginning of school, we haven't had any armed presence with the exception of a Pitcairn SRO who is currently on medical leave. So therefore there is no armed presence in any of our school buildings. And the Monroeville SRO did a very good job in the years that he was here. And I believe that it is important to reach out to the municipality of Monroeville and ask for the SRO at least until the school police decision is decided. I believe it's also on the agenda to have a motion to appeal the decision from Judge O'Reilly again.
It would be a refiling.
Okay. So in light of that, I do make a motion, and it's currently tabled, to hire a Monroeville SRO until the school police decision is decided.
Okay, and do we, just, I guess for clarification, do we have any numbers, any figures, are we making a motion just to?
This is to reach out to the municipality and see if they would be willing, I believe they are, and see what sort of offer they would be willing
I think that's a great idea. I'd actually even broaden the motion to include just looking at other departments, looking at other individuals, if it's going to be for a short period of time, and give ourselves options. See if Pitcairn has another officer available, see if the sheriffs are available. I think we should at least reach out and see what our options are if, you know, the main thing here is safety.
The main thing is safety. However, I would strongly recommend the municipality of Monroeville simply because they do have a current SRO that is trained, that we have used in the past, that we had a very positive experience with. So why not reach out to Monroeville?
I completely agree. We should reach out to Monroeville. I think we should just have options as a board to be able to deliberate.
Well, don't we need an SRO to be in the school? I mean, we just don't want to bring a police officer in that's not trained. Wouldn't it have to be a trained police officer?
No, an SRO is a certification, one of many that a lot of our law enforcement in our local communities obtain. So it's a 40-hour course that's completed over the weekend.
I had an opportunity to talk a little bit with Monroeville officials, and one of the things that I was advised of was that there were only two SROs trained in the Monroeville program at this point in time. So while, yeah, there may be others in the future, there are only a couple now, and one of those individuals, you know, has years of experience here with
They're
our students.
They're both Fort Tech, correct?
Yeah.
Well, further, the SR that we had in the past is an ALIS instructor. So again, if you want to continue with the school police force, you can certainly use the SRO to further advance the training of the school police force.
Yeah, absolutely. And we actually, the Pitcairn police officer also is ALIS instructor training.
The one that's currently out?
Yep, the one that will be back next week, correct?
He'll be back next week.
May I ask a couple questions?
Sure.
Before you do that, I think wouldn't a motion be in order to bring this off the table? Bring it off the table so that we can discuss it?
Yeah, that. Okay, so we have a motion by Stephanie. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Mary Beth?
Okay. In 1 week, we'll have five SROs. We have five guys going to training next week. So I'm not sure that it's really necessary that whatever officer we bring in to fill in, which I think is a great idea. I think filling in is a great idea. You know, I'm in favor of armed police, obviously. I don't know that it's required that they would be an SRO because we'll have five within a week. My concern with Monroeville that I would like answers to would be, you know, when we went to council, they were very adamant about a five-year contract. Attorney Dice said we could very well have our case wrapped up by the end of this year, which is less than 2 months away. So the other question would be, are they willing to forego a five-year contract and come in here on a temporary basis? And our other question, and we talked about last week, was trying to stay somewhat within budget is important, at least to me, and are they willing to come in at a lower cost? So when we approached Monroeville about keeping the SRO over the summer, they were adamant that they would not come down in cost. So to me, those are still issues that need to be considered, cost and the contract, because are you making a motion that we just bring somebody in until our court case is resolved? Or are you making a motion that, you know, we keep him longer than that?
Well, this current motion is until the school police decision is resolved. I would recommend certainly that once that has been resolved to discuss it further and have another vote as to what this board would like to do in regards to having a Monroeville SRO.
And just for clarification, Steph, when you had made the motion, it was to reach out to Monroeville and see what the price was, what they were willing to do, if they were willing to work, correct? Because I don't believe we're able to make a motion to hire someone without knowing. A contract without any understanding of any of that.
So we don't have those answers yet, correct?
How did the motion read?
The motion was to reach out to the municipality of Monroeville and ask for an SRO until the school police decision has been reached.
So it's more of fact-finding, correct? It's not
correct.
Employment.
Well, I mean, you have to go forth with a good faith effort knowing that the school board as a majority is interested in pursuing.
Well,
if it's the right price, if the right people, if it's the right thing,
if they come back with the 5 year.
We have a security force now too, whom it has to fit in with those guys too. Like, you know, Mr. Key and Mr. Perlowski is the head of our security. They're the head of our security.
Well,
I'm going to defer most of our decisions to them because they're going to tell me what they think.
Well, I would just say, you know, as board members, I think that we need to look at all information. I would caution anyone to vote on anything without us actually having information in front of us.
Right.
I know last time we had approached council, they said it was a five-year contract. It was the only way they were doing it, and it was $75,000. Again, this is a different circumstance. I think we should gather information, discuss it. With that being said, I would actually like to amend, so I make a motion to
Before you make a motion to amend, somebody Somebody has to second Stephanie's motion.
Valerie did.
Who did?
Valerie.
Is that to remove it from the table, or is that?
No, no. Well.
That was to remove it for discussion.
Okay.
Now there's been a motion to amend, or started to be.
So I make a motion to amend and just reach out to multiple law enforcement agencies that administration sees fit in order for us to make an educated decision. I think we should have all the information. I think the taxpayers would appreciate that. So I make a motion to amend to broaden instead of just asking one police.
I think
force.
George has some discussion on that.
Well, you need a second.
That question before you.
He needs a second, I think, on the motion.
Yes, I have a motion. Is there a second?
John seconds.
Okay, so we have a motion, we have a second to amend. Do we?
George wants to talk about that, I think. Now you have to vote on the amendment first.
And then we can discuss.
George, it's discussion time.
Okay. George?
I can talk now?
Yep.
I got a question for Mary Beth. You know,
yes,
you're
sir.
The chairperson for officers and everything.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you still know my feelings on SROs in Monroeville?
Yes, I do.
Is there any way we could reach out to the Allegheny Police? Because I'm concerned. Of all everything, we had one armed policeman at the high school at all times before. I don't care who we get, Allegheny County. I would appreciate if you could look into that, because if something comes down and we needed somebody with a handgun in that building, our heads are going to roll.
And that's what my amendment just did, is we'll reach out to multiple agencies, and that way the board will have multiple options to look over and discuss.
Okay, thank you.
You know, one of the things that one of the dynamics that's developed over the past year has been, unfortunately, a negative relationship between ourselves and the municipality of Monroeville. And I don't want to go back and revisit that, because there were many actors involved in bringing that. But I would bringing that to be. But I'd like to see us open negotiations only with Monroeville, because I think we're better off reaching out to the municipality's police force, that is essentially 90% of our own district, to determine whether or not we can work not only to repair the relationship, but also to get what would be considered by the board reasonable price, reasonable terms and conditions. Because I think what Mary Beth said about previous positions taken was right. They wanted, I think, a 5-year agreement, so on and so forth. So I'd like us to stay just within the scope of going.
But wouldn't that, happen if?
Hold on, just for clarification, you just want to get one bid then for that?
I only want to open up the discussions at this point in time. I would prefer just with the municipality of Monroeville. Okay. Now keep in mind that we would be discussing bringing back, presumably, an officer who has all of the kind of years of experience that that we would want. It wouldn't be someone who would have to be broken in new, so on and so forth. I think that would be in our best interest and the municipality's best interest. It would also work to repair the relationship if we were successful, but it could only be under terms and conditions that would be financially and otherwise acceptable.
I accept everything you say, except for one thing. And that would be, why can't we look at these other agencies and they'll give us a number, and what if that number's way less than, then we could go to Monroeville and say, hey, we really want you to do this. Could you please do it for this amount, or maybe some increment a little bit more, or somewhere between? I mean, we have no idea unless we actually go find out.
Yeah, but the flip side to your argument is you don't know what the other side of what you're getting with other forces. So you don't know when you're getting from a county police officer if they have SRO training, if they are adept at handling high school children. You know what you're getting with the Monroeville Police Force. We have had him here before. It was a very positive experience. Why wouldn't you want that back?
I just want to interject one thing there. I don't think we do know what we're going to get, but that is completely up to the municipality of Monroeville. I haven't seen anything that says if they were to give us an SRO, it would be the same SRO as last year. So that's why I think the amended version of reaching out to Monroeville, Pitcairn, I would just say Pennsylvania State Police, Allegheny County Police, and Allegheny County Sheriff, since they all have jurisdiction within parts of our communities, would be the best decision. Then we would actually have multiple ones to look at. Monroeville might not be able to offer us. I know, their SRO that served here has been promoted and is actually in a higher up position. I don't know if that will be the case. So I think reaching out and seeing what are our options, I think, would be the best option for.
May I comment? May I comment, Nacho?
Yep.
One of my sayings in life that I try to live by is a man with options has power. I think as long as you can get as many options as you can, it puts you in a position of strength in negotiation. One of our jobs here is to stay within budget and monitor the taxpayer money. I have a lot of friends who are Monroeville police officers, and I have a great respect for them, and they know that. And the problem with Monroeville is that they have priced themselves out of the market. So for us to go to them without any competition kind of basically says, give us whatever price you want, because we have no other options and we're not pursuing any other options. And I don't think that that's a good business decision. Now, let me give you an example. Last year, we paid for two police officers to work a football game through the municipality of Monroeville, $1,456 per game. This year, we're paying the sheriffs, who have the same powers, if not more, $705 per game. That's half. So who are we helping here if we're not willing to look at all options when we're going to answer to the public for how we spend their dollars? I think that it would be irresponsible to not at least look at other options. I'm not saying that we would have to go with the lowest price, but I'm saying to not give yourself options to me is not acceptable, and that we need to put all options on the table.
Jordy,
I just have one more question. Reaching out to everybody, you mentioned the picture and SROs too. That disturbed me a little bit because they don't have no jurisdiction in Monroeville. But Allegheny has as much jurisdiction or more than the Monroeville SRO. That's why I'd like you to look into the Allegheny place instead of a Pitcairn SRO.
Yeah, and that's why my motion would be the five of them. So Monroeville, Pitcairn, Pennsylvania State Police, Allegheny County Police, and Allegheny County Sheriffs. And that way we can get information for everyone, and then we can look at it from there.
Let me raise another point of view with respect to what Neil said. I wouldn't want to sit down and enter into a negotiation in bad faith with the other organizations that we went out and solicited, so to speak, bids from, or what your cost was, and then necessarily use that to leverage Monroeville into a different or a lower number. And I just think that's not fair to the others that would be coming forth in bidding. I also think that that we're quite capable, this board and management, quite capable of negotiating what we believe to be, the best deal, the best price for us, and the best terms and conditions for us as well. And again, I'm going to stress that by doing so, we get a person back, I think we would get, and that could be certainly part of our position, a person back in the saddle who knows and understands the kids, who knows our district well, who has all of the jurisdiction that is necessary. So we get the armed police officer, we get all the collateral benefits, and then in addition to that, we've opened up a pathway to repair the relationship with the district. That's important too, because Scotty, if he can hear me, would be able to elaborate on this more than I, but we oftentimes go to them for other kinds of services that are important. We want to use a high lift, or we want some special arrangement, or buy things through them. And those are all things that are conditioned upon the quality of the relationship that we have. Our relationship with them has deteriorated to a level that I've not seen in my previous term or during this year. I'm not pointing fingers. This, it's happened, it's happened. So another important collateral benefit would be to, through this, going back to Monroeville, would be to repair that relationship.
I agree, but I think that we found out one time, and I think we should do our homework again in terms of if we even ask the administration and or our security force what their opinions are. I would like to know if they think that would be beneficial for them, or is it just like we don't care what they say, it's just whatever we're gonna think is right, or should we ask them? Should we ask our security force what what do you, how you feeling in the schools? What's the status, right? Like, do you know, because I personally think that we are way more secure than we were before because we have more people.
Well, this is
performing that task.
This isn't a question, though, of going back to them and asking for their point of view. I think the question is, do we or don't we want an armed officer, which we do not have now, in that position?
We have one that's coming back next week. We could rotate them around. Maybe that's an option. There should be options to figure out what's the best thing for us to do.
You talked about repairing relationships, too. To me, that's a two-way street, Steve.
I agree.
And Monroeville could make a gesture to come in for free if they wanted to for a month and put an officer in our schools.
Sure.
That would be a really nice gesture.
I agree.
So there's a two-way relationship. I'm very willing to look at working with them, but I'm also committed to staying within budget. And remember, when we had budgeted $50,000 for an SRO and they wouldn't agree to that price, and we spent that additional monies on other things for the school police. So if you have the intention of furthering this, which I think you do, to bringing him back long term, we'll probably be about $100,000 over budget. So,
right, but I mean, wasn't it your intention also to give the school police jurisdiction?
No, they were going to have ability to write summary offenses and misdemeanors. That's all.
Right, and currently we don't have anyone with the ability to do so.
Is that a problem, Mr. Pulaski?
We have.
Is that a problem that Stephanie says that we don't have anybody who can write?
Why don't we not try to put or anybody else on the spot in the middle of these conversations?
I would argue that we do. We have 40-some individuals willing to do so, just like we have for years. If there's ever a case where a student or an employee or anyone rises to the level that an offense needs a summary or felony or anything like that, we call the Monroeville Police in. That's the same. That's how most school districts operate. That's how, you know, if something at the mall happens, they call the Monroeville Police, they write a summary offense. Something happens at a Steelers game, they don't have their own police force, they call the Pittsburgh Police and they write the offense. So yes, I would agree that, or I would argue that we do have a multitude of people able to issue citations available by dialing three numbers.
You know, it sounds to me like this board has a substantial agreement on almost all of the issues or facts that we're throwing out here. We agree we want somebody back in there with an armed officer. The only thing that might present itself as a problem is, do we just go to Monroeville, try to negotiate the best deal that we believe we can, or do we pass a motion that asks us to go out and solicit agreements or deals from the sheriff's office or state police or somebody else? I think that's pretty much the essence, isn't it?
I think you're right.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think that's, and we have two different points of view on it.
Yep.
We're probably ready for a vote on it.
Very good. Any other new or additional questions or comments?
Here's a question I'm going to have. Who's, I don't know if Scotty's coming in, but you know, talking about going out to all these different entities and getting quotes or whatever, I personally would like to get somebody in as soon as possible, and going out and, you know, seeing what the county sheriffs are going to do or what the state police will do. I mean, let's start off with Monroeville and see what Monroeville has to offer, see if it works within our budget. I mean, that's the first thing. Then if not, then branch out. But I think that we should go, my personal feeling, go straight to Monroeville, talk with them. I know they're willing to sit down. I would like to get them in as soon as possible.
Very good. Scotty, did you want to add anything?
Yeah, I sort of agree with Al, and I also said, should be the one that can report that, but
Mr. Short.
He wants you to
reach out
to Monroeville and report back to the board.
To all agencies or just primarily Monroeville?
I think he said Monroeville.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, any other new additional questions or comments?
Before we close the conversation here, I think this recording secretary should note that Neil said he agreed with me on almost everything, which I think is important. That's right, John. Exactly. So I just wanted to add that. Otherwise, I'm ready to vote.
Very good. Getting back to business. So the amendment.
If anybody had anything else to say, so I'm waiting for.
Okay, John.
Raise your hand. Speak up.
I have to raise my hand. All right.
So it is true that it would be good to have good relationships with one of the organizations that were mentioned, but any of the organizations that we picked, we could develop good relationships with them, and they would all have something good to bring to the table. Number two, we know that the Monroeville SRO has a good relationship with the kids, but it's also true that whoever we might pick from one of the other agencies might have better relationships, better experiences with kids in high school and junior high and elementary school. We don't know. They might have better, they might have worse. And since we don't know that, it's proper for us to ask those questions and get the answers. Third, as was already mentioned, the SRO that exists, that we have a good relationship with, that we really like, he may not be available. So if we negotiate strictly with one organization that's Monroeville, we might not get the one that we hope to get. So I think, therefore, for those three reasons, it's reasonable for us to ask the questions.
Very good. Thank you, John. So for clarification as to what we are voting on here, so there was a motion and a second to amend the original motion. So the motion that we will be voting on is to reach out to Monroeville, Pitcairn, Pennsylvania State Police, Allegheny County Police, and Allegheny County Sheriffs to see if they are able to provide an additional officer and what costs would be associated with that.
And that Mr. Short would perform the action and report back to the board, is
correct,
that right?
Correct. Administration would be reaching out. So a yes vote would be to reach out to the five agencies I just mentioned. A no vote would be not to reach out to the five agencies. Bonnie, if you could do roll call, please.
Do you need a second for that?
We had a motion.
No,
yep.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Yes.
Mr. Nola.
Yes.
Mr. O'Donnell.
No.
Mr. Ritter.
Yes.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Yes.
Mrs. Warning.
No.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
No.
Okay, motion passes 6-3. Okay. So with that being voted upon, we have nothing else under items previously tabled. With that, we'll move on to Section D, Personnel Agenda. Mrs. Crum.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenport. We welcome the Pitcairn Board of School Directors accepts and approves the Personnel Agenda items 1-5 as listed in Section D for the regular board meeting of Tuesday, November 15th. On the first page, we have five resignations listed. On the second page, we have transfers per the collective bargaining agreement. There are 8. Under leave of absence, we have 9. We're coming up on the second semester, so we will see more of those. For employment purposes, we have substitutes that we'll be adding this time. Teachers, teachers' aides, secretary, custodians, and food service. So we're very glad to see that. On Section F, we also do have a semester teaching position. That is for Kelly Rocco, daughter of Vicki Rocco. For Jackie Browning, who will be going out for a whole semester. So that is a long-term sub position. Section G for athletic director contract, approve the contract and appointment of Randy Rivesti as director of athletics for a term of 3 years effective July 1st. And under H, we have supplemental contracts listed for this fall, winter, and 8 volunteers listed.
Very good. We'll start with a question on G. Just so the public is aware, what is the salary listed in the contract?
It is his current salary, which is $62,000. It's for a 3-year contract where it stays flat. There's no increase.
Okay, and then the only other question I have, I would hope we've already looked into that. With him already being retired and collecting teachers, does that affect us at all, or are we opening ourselves up to any type of...
No, as we put into the board documents a couple of weeks ago, we reached out to PSERS on also to other agencies, and the contract that's drafted is the verbiage that comes from PSERS that would protect him and also the district.
Very good. Thank you.
I have a question on that. I think we're going to stay on that. Has the solicitor received the contract to review it?
I was in the room when it was discussed. I have not seen the actual contract. Okay.
Would it be a problem to have that contract shipped out to the solicitor for review prior to?
We can send it to you again. That's not a problem.
Okay. Good point, Steve. Thank you.
I have another question, but it's on another item in here.
Go ahead.
Mr. Minor, he's on page 1. Sort of help me, correct me if I'm wrong. Isn't this the gentleman that we spent some considerable amount of time trying to accommodate his employment? Pardon?
But he still was only half-time.
Yeah, but
he got another job.
I'm just wondering if I could finish my thought.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. He was the fellow that we spent some considerable amount of time crafting an arrangement for, and now he's leaving for personal reasons. Okay. All right. I just wanted to see if I had that right.
Yes, he received a full-time position.
Okay. Dealing with the same gentleman Mr. O'Donnell's talking about, is he also the supplementals?
He is continuing on in the board supplemental. He is currently videotaping downstairs as we speak. The other supplemental takes place during the day, so we are working with Mr. Murphy and Mr. Brown to see if that's something that we can create that supplemental. The problem is what was actually being implemented in the beginning of the year. So we're looking to see if that's still a viable option. It may be one of those things that we can make it a reduced supplemental and still be able to help out the video kids. So that's what we're currently looking into.
So administration will keep the board? Right.
Yes.
So he's leaving us, but he's retaining one or two supplementals with us?
One supplemental, correct.
Totaling how much money?
I think that one's $3,300. I don't have it right here with me, but it's around there.
You're good. Any other questions or comments?
Yes. On the K-4 STEAM curriculum coordinator.
Which item is that?
That will be the last one right before volunteers.
Page 6.
Supplemental contract.
Under the supplemental. Page 6. 6 of 6.
Yeah.
Instructional Gateway High School.
Yeah.
K-4 STEAM
yeah.
curriculum. Will she still continue as teaching, and when will this be done as far as the coordination of the STEAM program?
From my understanding, she currently is doing that now with the elementary STEAM program. It is outside of her working day, so it's just like the other curriculum coordinators. When we had the budget meeting in July, we had talked about that position, and this was kind of the arrangement that we all agreed to. Instead of the position, we would have a STEAM coordinator for elementary and secondary who would help with that curriculum and organizing.
Correct. And this just to reiterate, I guess that point was we were looking at a full-time position. We had agreed upon two supplementals. So I guess the valid point, just for clarification, though, she is still teaching full schedule.
Full-time, okay. Full schedule with Evergreen Elementary, grade
3.
2, 3.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, we will move on to Section E. Conferences and conventions. I'll turn that over to you, Mr. Short.
Mr. Sudenbort, for the board's review this evening under Section E, conferences and conventions, we have three conferences. John Fortier, assistant principal at Gateway High School, wishing to attend the Principals Association State Conference. Also, we have Paul Schott with PASBO Conference at David Lawrence Convention Center, along with Mrs. Crump.
Very good. Any questions or comments on conventions?
Well, is Dr. Fournier still there? That was Sunday. Is he back? Is Dr. Fournier back?
He was in ASOP, so I'm assuming
yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I just wondered.
I haven't talked to him today, but he wasn't
was
in ASOP.
I talked to him. I did not speak to him today.
So, question is then, they're doing conferences before we approve.
Depending, I don't do the actual conferences, but it depends on when they come in, especially when we do them this quickly.
I agree with Val. I think that is a problem. I mean, we could be, I've seen people go to Orlando for a week, 2 weeks for certain conventions and conferences, which is good if they're adding value, but I do believe these need to be board approved. If it's an absolute emergency and it cannot be placed before a board meeting, I think that the board should at least be notified, reach out to and consult you before moving forward with that.
So these are all retroactively being
one occurred 2 days
one.
Ago.
I'm sorry.
And
yeah.
I believe
yeah.
an opening came up where John Fortier was attending with and Lawrenceburg, which was approved in, the previous month.
So Adam was approved.
Yes.
Okay. And I don't see it being a problem. I think it's a good conference, but to Val's point, I think we should have board approval, and we should at least communicate that with the board. Mm-hmm. So just in the future, if any of those come up, if we could, please reach out. Any other questions or comments on conferences and conventions? All right. Good catch, Val. Thank you. Section F, administrative resolutions. We have an action agenda and a non-action agenda. We will start with the action agenda. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Student Board. We have item number one, the 700 section policies. This is for a 30-day public display. Approve the 30-day public display of the following revised policies, and they are listed. 701, school properties disposal. 702, gifts, grants, donations. Policy 708, lending of school owned equipment and books. 709, building security. And you can read through the rest of those. Also, we have been revising, and we want to include within the policy the exhibits that are also attached to those. So these would be for an action item for vote this evening.
Okay. Before we do that, since we didn't have a study session to discuss, if we could just get into that before we take a motion. I don't have a problem with these going on display because it is 30 days. The board will then have 30 days, the public will have 30 days to discuss. The one that I did want the board to look at though, so if you guys could just make note to review, is 707, the administrative regulation, as far as the fee schedule for facility rentals. That's one that's been in discussion multiple times throughout the past several years. If you guys could just read over what Mr. Short has prepared, any questions or comments, possibly have the athletic committee meet and discuss. Myself and Val, as the policy committee, can also meet and discuss and bring forward any other comments or recommendations at our November board meeting. So that'll still be within 30 days, and that way we can discuss that if we want to change that a little bit more. Just because I think there are a few different opinions there. So if we could just make sure everyone reads.
Language has been identified as being changed, I believe, if it's read.
I believe Janet had highlighted it in red, highlighted it in yellow too.
So board members should just read that over, and then we can have more discussion. We will have 30 days to review this, as will the public, as will be on display.
Unless I've missed it, has that come out already? Underlying the score.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah. On the board docs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Highlighted.
Good chance.
Okay. And with that being said, also if we could just make sure that is switched, those are visible after tonight's meeting. Mm-hmm. Well, I guess, if this passes, those are switched so the public can also look at them. Okay. Any other discussion with that?
We do need a motion and a second.
Do you want to go over number two? Cool.
Defer to.
On number two, it's payment to the AMCA Systems LLC to purchase ACA Tax Track software license to assist with the Affordable Care Act tax reporting requirements. We do have this within the budget. We were not for sure if we were going to get the service again, but it was an invaluable service as far as his tax expertise, the legal advice they gave us, and as this is just the second year in the ACA reporting, we're not sure what's going to come at us.
Is this something that needs to be purchased before the 15th?
We get a discount, so yes, if we could, that would be wonderful, if I can get it in.
Okay. We will then seek a motion for approval of number one and number two is action.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second.
I'm still processing my motion, but I'll second it.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to approve number one and number two. Do we have any questions or comments? Okay, seeing none, Bonnie, motion for both of those, please. Or we'll call both of those.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Yes, aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Scrucci?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll move on to now Section F, Administrative Resolutions, Non-Action Item. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbort. Administrative Resolutions. We do have a number of facility agreements in place. For this upcoming summer and also into the winter, the American Cancer Society is requesting to use the high school stadium, concession stand, and cafeteria.
Also, we have a Gateway High School Family and Consumer Science fundraiser for a Gateway teacher whose daughter is in need of a liver transplant, Reagan Reeder from Evergreen. We also have the Greater Johnstown Career and Technology graduation practice and graduation at Gateway Middle School. On page two, you'll see noted the Atlantic Coast softball and baseball tournament, utilization of our baseball fields and softball fields for those dates listed. Item number two, Mr. Schott.
Thank you, Mr. Short. Item number two, administration will be seeking approval for extension of the current agreement with UGI Energy Services for natural gas transportation services through the Western Pennsylvania Natural Gas Consortium. That's administered by the Allegheny Intermediate Unit. And very happy to announce that the price will continue to go down from a negative 43 cents to a negative 48 cents. So again, just a result of the glut of natural gas that's available out there due to all the drilling and everything.
What do you mean a negative? I mean below zero?
It's below zero. It actually is below zero.
How does that work, below zero?
It actually ends up being a credit.
A credit to us?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that would be also a credit to you then. Good job.
It's a great item for you. I mean, yeah. It's almost unprecedented that we see something like this.
What does that total up to, credits wise?
You know what? Honestly, I haven't looked at that to see. Obviously, based on our consumption amount through that, but
is it hundreds of dollars or thousands of dollars?
Oh, easily.
Hundreds
compared to that. One of the nice things to note, even though our current agreement actually runs through August 31st of 2017, the pricing will actually go effect December of 2016. So we'll get, even though it's still a nickel difference, but still a nickel. So again, a credit to the folks that are administering the program through the Allegheny Intermediate Unit. And item number three, administration will be seeking continued membership in the Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3's Joint Purchasing Board for 2017. And again, you know, natural gas is one of those items, electricity as well. Myself and Mrs. Crump would be the regular member and the alternate member as depicted in Exhibit B. And finally, item number four, administration will be seeking approval for submission of the Pennsylvania Department of Education PlanCon Part K project refinancing documents and associated backup information for the general obligation bonds fairly taxable for the refunding series of 2016. Again, these are the bonds we just reissued as part of refinancing. And since these are PlanCon reimbursable debt service payments, this is a requirement whenever it's being reimbursed, refunded, we submit these documents to PD so they analyze those and officially acknowledge that's taken place.
Very good, thank you. Any questions or comments on any of this? Very good, then we will move on to Section G, resolutions presented by board members. I have two this morning, neither of which will be for action item, just for discussion, and we can move those to motion on the 15th. The first one I will actually let Mr. Dice explain.
Yes, as you're aware, there have been several meetings of discussion since the O'Reilly opinion. If you remember, Judge O'Reilly said that we should put more thought into this matter. Judge O'Reilly's opinion doesn't say he would never approve this matter. I would indicate to you that there has now been more discussions. I have a complete resolution here that I will pass out. The one you have in the booklet here is just an abbreviated portion. In this resolution, there are certain considerations that we've given. That is, there has been more discussions and deliberation. Attached to this resolution are two clinical opinions indicating support for this program, both from area psychologists. There has also been an amendment to what the prayer is, or the request for relief. If you remember, we originally requested carrying firearms, arrest powers, and issue citations. We have eliminated the arrest power, so it's not now the same request for relief that you originally made back in July and heard in August. So with that, I would ask that you would consider adoption or at least action on this matter in your November 15th meeting. I want to say any questions you might have.
Where's the full copy? I'm sorry.
There, it's coming down.
Does this
paper.
Go to a different judge? Maybe. It could.
It very well could. And most likely in Allegheny County, you would never see the same judge. I mean, there's 43 judges.
Okay. Any questions on that one? And again, with us receiving the full one, if we could also...
You can look at it, look at the clinical studies there, and you'll see the elimination of the arrest powers, which changes, again, the relief sought.
Okay. So again, this is not for action. This is just for everyone to look over, and we can discuss.
Yeah.
If anyone has any questions right now, feel free to ask, and then if not, we'll do it.
The chain of events would be the same as you did this summer, and that would be you would look at this now, you would either act to approve or deny it on the 15th. If you acted to approve it, then we would be in a position to go back into the court system and seek approval.
Okay. Any questions? Seeing none, we will move on to my other.
No, no. This is strictly this is pre-decisional in nature. I caution you all that this is pre-decisional in nature, and it shouldn't be given to the press until you've acted on it.
Okay. The resolution itself, ma'am, will be available.
Yes, it
will. And you've got, anyone in the public is more than welcome to come on the 15th and ask any questions or speak to it.
It will be online, so I can see it before.
The resolution itself, yes, will be online.
Thank you.
You're welcome, ma'am. The second one is a motion, actually, just revisiting a motion that we had discussed.
Can I interrupt before you even say anything, Chad?
I'd like to present it, and then we can have discussion on it. So the motion is verbatim what was voted down last meeting, and what that is to look at ABM. When we took a request for a proposal, they were one of seven to inquire, and they were ultimately the one that was selected by our staff here at Gateway. The reason I wanted to bring it up, I know there were a few comments made last week. I had discussions with a few board members that weren't really sure of the scope, had a few questions on the operations and some aspects of that. So I'm bringing it forward again, simply because I believe that we do need to move forward on working on some of these buildings. I believe that we need to move. You know, we've been kicking down the can year after year. We have roofs that are leaking. We have problems that could cost us immensely in the future if nothing is done. So again, this proposal is really just allowing them to go in, evaluate all of our assets, make recommendations as to a grade, so an A through an F grade, as to what assets need to be replaced sooner rather than later. Then as a board, we can sit down and we can decide, okay, what does need done? What can we handle in-house? For instance, the roofs that we did last year, I think we had a good working relationship between our staff and the roofers, and that might be something that I would, not might be, that would be something I suggest that we do, just go out for bid again and move forward with a project like that. But there are other projects. For instance, you know, we had talked about the lights. Someone had alluded to, well, we have staff, can't they change the lights? So we went through and we did the math, and we looked at how many lights are in the district as a whole. And if we had one dedicated maintenance person to do that, it would take a year and a half to replace all of the lights moving forward. So when we're looking at this is really looking at a large investment in the schools, which I think is necessary in order for us to continue to offer great educational experience to the students, to the staff, and to the teachers here at Gateway. Our grades have been going up. I think the board is definitely dedicated to offering first-class education. I just want to make sure that our students are safe while receiving that first-class education, and I believe we need to have solid and sound structures in order to do that. So again, this motion would not be to spend a dollar. This would be to move forward with getting a list of what they would recommend doing. The board could then deliberate and look at moving forward. If we were to move forward with anything on that list, we would not be charged a fee whatsoever. If we decided, okay, we're not going to put anything into the buildings, we're not going to do any capital improvement projects, then we would be billed $50,000. To put that into perspective, someone had mentioned last week also that we get or hire an architect to look at this. So I'm going to actually pull up some of our architect fees that we had spent over the last few years for subjects that we did not move forward with. Excuse me.
Could I interrupt just for a moment?
Absolutely.
You know, I don't, you understand my position. I don't think we need to relitigate this issue. I mean, I understand where you're coming from, and I understand that you want to, you know, bail together an argument to bring ABM back to the table. I don't see the value in that. The board's already made a decision on it.
Steve, can I interrupt you? Can sure. I make a motion to take this off of the agenda?
Is that a motion to table?
No, to take it off the agenda completely. Can I do that?
I second it.
Okay, there's a motion and second. Can we do a roll call, Bonnie, please?
Discussion?
Well, I'm just going to bring it back up under board resolutions, but we can have a discussion on that if we'd like to.
So I'd like to ask the question, why,
Steve? We had a sort of a lengthy conversation at this, but I don't think vendors get 2, 3, 4 bites at the apple. I think this, I've read this and maybe it was one of just a few people who read the whole proposal. This is not a program that the administration supports. This is not a program that is in our best interest. It is financially burdensome to this district. The contract language is troubling, to say the least, and I've shared any number of issues with you regarding that. I just think that this matter has been chewed on, and from my to a point where it no longer makes sense to me. I'm troubled why any one single vendor gets 2, 3 bites. This is the third bite at the apple. We've made a decision. It starts to feel very troublesome. I mean, I had a conversation with Neil about this today. I talked at length with Bob Brown. There'll be a program put on that will go to the issues that were raised in the ABM program and others at the upcoming Buildings and Grounds Committee, which will, I think, attack and resolve these issues at a savings of millions of dollars. Unless you want me to bring up all of the issues already,
I just want to rebut.
I don't want to go through that again.
Okay. Let me respond to what you just said.
Sure.
By asking Mr. Schott and Mr. Dice a question. When a school board turns down a given proposal from a given entity, and that entity refreshes some of the statistics and makes it generally more digestible for the school board, is that a generally accepted practice or contract negotiation? In other words, to do it that way? Or, as Steve is saying, once a bid is put forward and once the board has voted on it, then that's final. There's no need to revisit it. It's not a common practice to revisit that specific request for proposal response.
You just sit there, all right? I'm gonna tell you what I see historically. You can do it either way, but historically, what I see is when a contract is voted down, it's generally voted down and you move on. But that doesn't mean that you can't go back and, well, the deal's changed a little bit and revisit it again. But historically, generally, once a governing body has acted upon something, you go to the next issue.
Okay, but kind of like what we're doing with the thing you just handed out there.
Correct.
We're doing the same exact thing, though, with this.
Well,
come on.
Oh, I don't
okay.
see that.
Well,
I just want to add a few points here.
We're revisiting the Monroe.
Revisit what Steve had said. We did vote on the Monroeville SRO as a board, and we've just all as a board voted to reevaluate. I think to say that once you vote on one thing, you should never reevaluate it.
I'm not saying that. I agree with you.
Yeah, I just don't think that's best practice. I think it can be detrimental to a district or to any entity.
Chad, I want to interrupt you. That special meeting that was held last week, that the whole board did not know about, I was fortunate enough to be able to sit in on it. And as I want to quote, I don't know if I'll get it exactly right, as Mr. Nolas says, that, you know, the recommendations from administration that we should listen to the recommendations from administration.
Yes, and Bob Brown did recommend moving forward.
Okay,
who was in charge of buildings and grounds.
That's one. That's one administration. I believe two of our other administrators, I don't want to put anybody in the spot, but Mr. Schott and Mr. Short, both do not feel this is what they want to go with. So
I think you should put them on the spot.
Okay, I'll put them on the spot. It's fine with me. But what I'm saying is, okay, you're talking, you know, we were sitting in the meeting that there was only myself, Mr. O'Donnell.
Well, and I can go through board policy and really go through procedurally why that occurred that way. So after speaking with Mr. Short in our school board president and superintendent meetings.
You are the school board president.
Yes, so in sitting in our school board president and superintendent meeting.
You said
meeting,
you were talking with your school board president.
We had discussed the ABM proposal. There were still some points of uncertainty. He did have questions, and I arranged a meeting between the two of them. All meetings are not attended by all board members, and actually, if there's five board members or more, it has to be a public meeting and it has to be advertised. So I had set up a meeting that I was unable to attend with Mr. Short and with ABM. If you guys choose to attend, as I know you come to the school a lot, that is your doing, and I obviously did not ask for that not to occur. So just to clarify, it was not a special or public or secret meeting. It was simply a meeting between the superintendent of schools and a vendor that's possibly offering us a solution of $10 million in savings and repairs that are desperately needed throughout the school.
Okay, well, at the end of the meeting, when it was, they were done talking, it did come up, the administration did not feel that ABM was the company they wanted to go with.
Is that true? How do we know that that's true?
They're sitting here. Ask them.
Okay.
We're asking. Bill?
Well, we'll start with Paul. Paul had items that he wanted to present to the board, then I will provide my input at right after Paul gets done.
All right. Please bear with me. I have nothing personal against ABM. I am fundamentally opposed to the various concepts behind the utilization of Act 39 2010 by the district. We have reviewed this capital repair option through discussions with several different firms like ABM during the last several years. And we always came back to the same realization: we don't need to utilize Act 39 of 2010 to make required capital repairs. In my opinion, Act 39 of 2010 is a financing mechanism for an entity with no other available financial resources available to fund capital repair projects. The district is currently in a very strong financial position to self-fund a substantial number of smaller capital repair projects, again, still to be officially determined and agreed to by the board on its own from the general fund. The district has the financial ability to self-fund such projects, and the district even stated in its recent bond refinancing official statement and no additional financing is contemplated by the school district within the immediately foreseeable future. I define that statement to mean no additional financing in at least the next 12 months for the district. One of the base concepts behind Act 39 in 2010, specifically replacing old equipment with new equipment that will reduce future related expenditures, is so basic and does not require an outside vendor to explain such a concept for a district to realize such a positive result will take place in the form of various types of reduced expenditures. Sharing a portion of the district's savings in the forms of reduced utility expenditures and reduced maintenance department repair time and repair parts with an outside vendor is not necessary nor desirable. Why should the district share any new equipment purchase rebates available through Duquesne Light Company directly resulting from the district's installation of new efficient HVAC equipment with any other third-party entity other than the district itself? I don't like the concept of one outside entity performing all phases of a project. Too much control without additional third-party input in the design and post-performance phases of a particular capital repair project, particularly an Act 39 2010 project, is not ideal or a desirable situation. The district can utilize the services of an architectural firm and an engineering firm as necessary to develop bid specifications the district would like to utilize for a particular type of capital repair project. For instance, the district may desire to utilize Trane products for HVAC upgrades as opposed to merely utilizing equipment that, quote, maintains a high standard of quality. Thus, I again state I am fundamentally opposed to the district's proposed utilization of Act 39 2010 as a funding mechanism.
Now, those are strong arguments, and I'd like to hear Mr. Short follow up on that.
I think you might have a question for Mr. Schott before we move to Mr. Short.
Just real quick. Your comments that you just read, I agree with them 100%.
I do too, actually.
There's a problem with your comments, though. You're looking at this from a act, whatever act you said.
Act 39.
And the reason I don't even know the act is because I don't intend on using the act. So every single thing that you said, very eloquent and very nice. We do intend to self-fund this without using the act. That does not preclude us from utilizing a company to help us determine what should be done, when should things be done, and to actually move us to actually do, which we have not done. And also, the rebates that you speak of, the rebates do go directly to us. There's only one, it's not even called a rebate, it's a tax relief. It is not a rebate that goes, that we have the option of giving to them, if we so desire. So, as I fundamentally agree with every single thing you said, you started your premise off by, and you ended your premise, your opening and your closing line talked about Act 39, and I'm not even considering Act 39, so I'm going to have to set your piece of paper on the side then, I think.
I agree, you know, and I want to visit one thing as well.
I
want to
visit
with
something
that,
as well, Chad. Well, I want to visit before we go too far. Neil, the things that you were saying are just simply not accurate.
Oh, yes, they are.
No, they aren't, because you didn't read the contract.
Yes, I did.
And I did read the contract, and I read it verbatim, okay, word by word.
And the manager corrected you.
Excuse me, okay? And that contract language says quite clearly that they own the tax credits and the rebates and anything else of that sort that goes along with it. Now, Neil said to me earlier, that's not the contract. Well, if that's not the contract, what do they give us it for? Why are they giving us this document? I just think that we need to be very careful when we talk about things like moving to go with this company because we're going to save millions of dollars to the public. We're going to save millions of dollars for the public regardless. Agreed. These are no bid contracts, the worst kind of a deal to enter into. And it troubles me that you as the president are bringing this up again and again, meaning for the third time. We've made a decision on this. I think we need to move on. But I think the public needs to understand that this outfit, and listen, I'm nothing against them. I don't know them from a hole in the wall. But this proposal is a terrible proposal for this district from a contractual basis, from a bid basis, from a quality of instrumentation basis. There's nothing in this proposal that in any way, shape, or form should lead us to make a decision to go with them. Everything that they talked about in there, we can do ourselves, and we can do it for less money than they propose. Remember, they're going to mark up the markups. And so to suggest to the public on television that somehow a vote against this is a vote against saving millions of dollars is not accurate.
Okay.
Not accurate at all.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Arnold.
And let me go one more step further. Mr. Brown did not read the contract, did not read the proposal.
Okay,
Mr. Brown didn't read the proposal. I asked him that today, and he said straight up he hadn't read the proposal. So why are people pushing to go with ABM on a program that you haven't read?
If I can speak, I will
fill
you in. Okay, so I had three board members recommend an A&E firm, an architect and engineering firm. Mr. Schott has now just mentioned an A&E firm. So let me just go through some of these invoices with you. $82,000 was spent on secure vestibules, exterior restoration and repair projects, none of which were moved forward. Let me finish, Mr. Adon, since I let you finish.
Yeah.
$82,000 was spent. That's one invoice, and I have multiple if you're writing them all down. That was spent, and nothing was moved forward with those projects. The problem with an A&E firm is they're getting paid regardless. They're getting paid their 5-7%. Regardless of whether or not you move forward with the project. The benefit to moving forward with a company like this, like ABM or the multitude of others that are out there, is not the Act 39. I completely agree with Mr. Noll. We're not looking at it from a guaranteed savings. I view that as a bonus. I view it as Mr. Schott accurately does, we can pay for a lot of these projects out of pocket. For the next 3 to 4 years, I think we should invest a large amount of money towards projects. The problem is, the board has never been able to accurately evaluate what projects need to move first, what projects need to be second, what projects can be delayed 5 years, what projects can be held off for 10 years. We don't have an idea. And unless we hire someone to go through and do all of those, and not just one person, a team of individuals to do those, because look, the architect and engineering firms, just for looking at the vestibules, just for looking at the restoration repairs, and then all their $18,000 or $19,000 general services fund, which I love that line item, is spent, and we don't get anything out of it, other than the fact that, hey, if we do want to move forward with it, here you go. So on another one, invoice number three, we're looking at $69,000, $24,000 for secure vestibule at Ramsey and rearranging the Ramsey School District. We paid $23,000 and not one thing was moved around. So if we want to sit here and say, oh, we can hire an architect and engineering firm and we can do all this work and they can tell us what needs to be done. Oh, they can. They sure can. And it's going to come with a large price tag, which is fine if you move forward with the work. The benefit to ABM, the only benefit that I see that is a talking point to me, is we get a list of every single asset we own, what it's rated at, how long they believe the usable life is. And we have a boiler system here in this building. If it goes during a school day, I sure as hell do not want to be on this board if that occurs. We have a roof at Ramsey that is leaking like a sieve. We have HVAC units that are not working. We spent $17,000 for air conditioning units that go in the windows because we're having problems, and we have other schools that aren't air conditioned. I think we can all agree things need to be done. I believe that the best way to do that is to look at everything we have and develop a plan, develop a five-year plan as to what's going to take place and when. If we think that the best way to do it is get an architect and engineer firm and pay them, and then we realize, okay, well, this can be held off, so we're going to pay $5,000 for that, and this can be held off, and we're paying for that, then so be it. And I'm not going to stop the board from voting any which way they want to, but I at least want to bring it up again and allow board members, because I did have board members say they had questions, they had concerns about the proposal that they had just voted down. So yes, I am going to bring it up. I am bringing it up for the second time. You had incorrectly noted the third time. And just another invoice is another $13,000, of which about half of that we did not move forward with. So we're talking about almost, you know, $200,000 of items that we never move forward with that we spent. If we don't move forward with a single thing with ABM, we spend $50,000. Now, I don't think that's going to be the case. I think we're going to move forward with projects because things need done in the school.
Yours is an interesting – are you done?
I am done.
Yours is an interesting argument.
Let me know when it's my turn, too.
Yours is an interesting argument. What you're basically saying is that this board ought to take a vote to spend millions of dollars that it doesn't have to spend because some prior board made decisions to hire architects and didn't then follow up with what they said they were going to do. That's not this, unless you were part of that board, that's not occurred on my watch. It hasn't occurred on your watch. It didn't occur on at least the five board members who were just elected. Okay? So that argument, I'm sorry, just pales. I'm not going to vote to spend millions of dollars over and above what we have to spend because a prior board made decisions to hire architects and then didn't follow through on them. That's their problem.
But do we know what the costs are?
What do you mean?
The next step is figuring out what the costs are.
Listen, we have a building and grounds committee. We'll bring those numbers to you, to this board.
Okay, but what I'm saying is right now we don't have those numbers in front of us. So the next step would be to get those numbers in front of us. So we're saying, well, it's going to cost us this astronomically high amount. Where's the proof?
Do you understand that these are no-bid contracts, Chad?
I understand that you're asking that we vote.
That these people can go out and ask for any amount of money that they want and push it back to us. There's no way I'm going to enter into a no-bid contract. No way at all. That's the worst way to move. I believe it is. The worst way to move, and it's the way school districts get scammed.
Very good. Steve, I have a question. Would you consider the Monroeville bid that you had recommended we move forward with earlier a no-bid contract?
Which
we're
going
to one vendor.
Which Monroeville bid?
When you had recommended we go to
Monroeville.
Come
on, we're talking about $50,000 worth is $11 million. They're not the same deal.
I'm asking a question. Do you view that as a bid?
No. Okay?
Okay, so
we're talking about an entirely different proposition. You're talking about mistakes. Maybe they are.
that prior board members made, and you want us to pay millions of dollars over and above what I think we can do these jobs in-house with the expertise of this board and what the people we have hired on. And on the 15th, we're going to have a Building and Grounds Committee meeting to do that. We don't need ABM and their enormous markup to do that.
Very good. I appreciate that. I respect everything you've had to say. I brought it up simply because we don't have another option on the table. I am ecstatic to see what options you bring to the table. And with that, Mary Beth, you've been waiting. Mary Beth, go ahead.
Do you want to go first?
Yeah. Honey, only thing I'm concerned about what Steve was saying about our maintenance supervisor not even reading the contract from front to back like he did and a few other people did. I count on them people to do my homework for me. That's what they get paid for. And if they don't know that much about roofs or central air conditionings or plumbing, electricity, or they're just good for fields or Three River Stadiums and whatever, I think we made a mistake by hiring this gentleman. We should have an all-around man that should be able to go on that roof and tell me how much life is left on that roof or an air condition, because there's few people that can do that. And I would have rather paid an extra $10,000 or $20,000 for a man like that instead of paying architects and everything else. He could give me the answers as soon as he looks at the projects. Thank you.
Very good. Mary Beth?
I like you after Mary.
All right. I'm sorry. I have a lot of notes on this, and I do want to get it out only because I want the public to hear the other side of this, too. Okay? So the problem that I have with us not going with ABM is that you're proposing that we go back to the drawing board, basically. So, Val, you mentioned that we had a meeting with ABM after it was voted down. Well, they wanted to give us some data as they closed the door on the relationship. And what we found was they looked at 1,300 assets, which, by the way, took a team of, I think, 7 to 12 engineers to assess. So I did mention to Mr. Brown if he could do that himself, and he said it would probably take him a couple years to do the analysis they did. But they looked at 1,300 assets in all of our district facilities, and they grade them on an A to F scale. 84% of our assets had a grade of C, D, or F. We have $12 million of needs identified over the next 5 years. I think we had $5 million was the number he gave of upgrades that should have been done by, I'm going to say, previous boards and did not. So to me, we're $5 million in the hole of where we should be because we're that behind in upgrading facilities. Now, I'm going to give you another one of my cliche sayings that I like. The other one is, a wise man seeks the counsel of many. So I did that in since our meeting, trying to reassess, you know, everything that happened with ABM. And I talked to, happened to be my brother, who is a mechanical engineer, and he is a structural analyst at Bettis Bechtel. He is 9 years my senior, so he's been doing this about 30 years. And what he does is he analyzes mechanisms on the nuclear reactors on submarines, and he analyzes data with the goal of preventing failure. Okay, stay with me, because I'm going to bring this around to ABM. So what he says is, when you have a nuclear submarine engine, you have different structural requirements of all those parts that make that engine work properly, and you don't want it to fail because obviously you'd have a catastrophe. And he said what happens is there are certain parameters that everything needs to work in. So what they do is they analyze those parameters regularly, and if something is off, if something is working too hot or too cold or not within the parameter, that's a variance. Well, what happens is sometimes people accept variances, which is what we've been doing at our schools. We've been accepting variances, and it's called normalizing deviance, okay? So we're normalizing deviance of our boilers, of our heating and cooling systems, of our electrical systems, because we think that nothing has happened yet, that nothing's going to happen. And the reality is things catastrophically fail because you normalize the deviance, nothing bad has happened, and this compounds. And as it continues to compound, as you're sitting there doing nothing, accepting this deviancy, you have a catastrophic failure. So again, to reiterate, our school systems aren't meeting requirements. We have been informed that we have equipment that is nearing end of usable life and past usable life. To me, if something is past its usable life, we're normalizing deviancy there. And we have multiple issues where we do that, and we are going to have a catastrophic failure. That is my biggest concern, and I've said that to a few of you in our discussions. And the other thing is you analyze data to build and make decisions. This board continues to analyze and analyze and analyze, and we're not making a decision. The goal of our analyzing these bids and the goal of our analyzing, and these conversations are still good, is to actually make a decision. And to me, going back to the drawing board is not a good decision. I would rather see us revise the contract with ABM, take out the language that Steve's not happy with, remove that rebate line, self-finance. You know, we put out an RFP and we asked them to give us financing options. My other cliche, right? A man with options has power. So we know our option, but we don't have to choose to finance. I think all of us are in agreement, and we're all pretty fiscally conservative, that we do not want to finance all this money and go into a ton of debt. So I don't understand why we're starting over. The concerns to me for the public is that we're going to have a catastrophic failure, and to start over is not the best decision. It would be really to revise what we have and work with that and improve it. The safety issue with Ramsey's electrical system and the boiler system at Mossside are very real situations. Mr. Brown told me that that boiler overheated, and it does have a chance of causing fire. That is serious, and I do not want to be viewed as negligent because we, as I said, kick this can down the road for 6 more months while we go get an architect and we go get bids. And by the way, an architect typically costs 5 to 7%. So if we have identified $12 million of upgrades, to me that means an architectural fee is going to be a little over $500,000. So I'm not convinced that going with an architect is the way to go to save us money. And I've talked to our facilities manager, who's flat out told me that he can't manage these programs ourselves. And you think that maybe you can manage them, but I'm not qualified in facilities management. I was hired to make sure that we hire the right people to do that and facilitate these projects. But it is not my job as a school director to actually step in and manage these projects. Our job is to oversee the projects. I think that's all I have to say. Thank you for hearing me out.
Very good. John?
I don't see any reason why we couldn't implement some of those past studies. Not that we would do it immediately, but they should go into the mix of the next steps that we'll take after we have the buildings and grounds meeting. In other words, we have many things on our plates, but some of them we've already studied, so that can help us understand where we want to go next. So that's all I wanted to say, but that was quite cogent.
Thank you. Any other further discussion?
I do. Oh, you know what? Do you want to talk first?
I'll defer to you.
Thank you. Okay. I just asked Mike, and he hasn't answered me yet. If you go to the tech department, which I hate to bring them up, which I said in our meeting when we were sitting with ABM, that, you know, we're saying Mr. Brown can't tell us how many air conditioners, how many boilers we have, how many, you know, when they were installed. As a manager in the school district, mm-hmm. he should be able to know, with the records that we have, if they had records, what the shelf life is left on these air conditioners, the computers, the boilers, everything that we're talking about. I don't want to say computers, that was the wrong one. I could go to Mr. Short could go to, Mr. Shaw could go to, any of us could go to the tech department and say, okay, that printer that's over at Ramsey, when was that installed? You know, how much life do you think is left on it? They're going to be able to tell you. I know it's a smaller version of it, but why doesn't Mr. Brown, our maintenance manager, have everything documented, like where everything is?
Okay. Do you want me to answer that or you?
Okay, I'm just saying that's, for instance, and I am very best that you said it would be, you know, very hard for him to do, but I still feel, okay, we have the people that are working. This is my idea. Maybe it's not right, but this is my thing. We have enough custodians, men at night, that are working that aren't going to be working, I'm going to say, a whole 8 hours. It's not going to take them 8 hours to go and look and say, okay, the air conditioners we have in this building, here's a serial number, and everything's documented. Okay, I don't understand why that couldn't have happened down the road. Going to another version, I've talked to a very good friend of mine who does commercial air conditioning. He says the same thing. We're being taken for a ride if we go with the contractor like this, because they can up their prices. Your best bet is to go with individual contractors and have it for the plumbers. You have them out there that will be more than glad to bid on commercial plumbing, commercial air conditioning, which everything's going to be. Give that an opportunity instead of going and saying, okay, here, you take over. We don't know what we're getting. We were sitting in the meeting when George had asked him, okay, we're looking at all the air conditioning you have listed. What were some of the air conditionings? I can't remember. Train, Bryant, Mitsubishi.
Yeah.
And he said, how do we know we're getting the top brand instead of the lower brand? I mean, they're all going by Train. Who's to say we're getting the best? There's no guarantee because there's no bid. They're giving us what they want to give us without actually saying. Well,
that's true.
Well, I just want to answer a few questions you had there. The one about why can't we have custodians go around and read serial numbers? I think we'd have a lot of grievances against maintenance if we did that. Number two, the difference between technology versus capital assets are technology, right, the shelf life of a computer, for instance, is a certain number of years. Usually, I think the last budget meeting we talked was about 5 years. So it is fairly easy to understand that. On top of that, we don't take a computer and just add spare parts and add spare parts and add spare parts to the point that it's 50 years old with a multitude of different hands touching it and a multitude of different Band-Aids on it. When you look at HVAC units, that's what we have. We have a unit that was installed. It has a 20-year lifespan, and then we hit that 20-year lifespan, and boards are very slow to come by decisions sometimes. So they decide, well, we won't do that. We can do a Band-Aid for $1,000. Oh, we can do this for $10,000. Oh, we can do this. We had to, at Ramsey, right, we had to bring in people this year to sit up there all day for however many days to put another Band-Aid on that. So it's not just as simple as saying, okay, this computer's going to last us 5 years. After 5 years, we should get all new laptops. So I don't want to, I just don't think that's accurate in order to say that. And I just don't like attacking one of our administrators in that way. So I just didn't want that to go out there.
Can I make a response then just for a moment to Mary Beth, the comments? I think we really need to be careful when we use terms like catastrophic failure. Listen, if a roof has a catastrophic failure, it's going to leak, okay? Ramsey is a built-up roof on a steel plate, all right? Probably already leaks. It probably could last for another 10 years leaking. We're not going to experience some roof cave-in. Now, if the boiler, because I heard the same comments about the boiler, then my admonition, and I'm certain that Mr. Brown would have already taken every step required to ensure that that thing didn't reach some critical step. But with roofs and air conditionings and light bulbs and condensers and faucets, and we don't need this company. We just don't need them. We can do it ourselves. It'll take a little work. We can put a plan together in a very short period of time. Now, we need to act on it. I certainly agree with that. But we can do it ourselves, subbing it out to commercial HVAC, commercial roofing, commercial electrical, commercial plumbing, and have all of this done by the end of summer. We don't need to pay somebody to go into a non-bid proposition. We'll get all of our own tax credits. We'll get all of our own rebates. Paul's already checked into that. And if this board acts reasonably quickly, I guarantee you can all be done by the end of summer. That's HVAC, that's roofs, that's faucets, that's all the low-hanging fruit that you're talking about. And we'll enjoy the benefit of all the credits. We'll get the money back. And our buildings will be, as Chad said, upgraded and a more commodious, appropriate environment for learning. We don't need to pay ABM millions of dollars over and above what we can do it ourselves. So that's
quick rebuttal.
Well, going off of that, I mean, this isn't rocket science. If you have a boiler that is overheating, I find it hard to believe that our director of maintenance has not yet come to us and said, this boiler could very well cause a fire. I mean, if that is the case, I'm very upset that he hasn't come to the board and said so.
He has in this 5-year plan.
Well, if this credit. Is, if you're talking about something critical as though it's about to happen tomorrow, if that is the case with this boiler, then I would hope that this board can make the decision to replace the boiler without hiring an outside company and paying $50,000 to tell them for them to tell us to do so.
Just to answer that, I agree. And he has recommended on multiple occasions that is one item to look at and to address. This board, as well as the previous board, though, has continually said, let's focus on the four elementary schools that we know are not closing and the high school. We're not sure of what the game plan is between the junior high and the middle school. That was very evident in January at everyone's all new board member second meeting, where we voted down a study which would show us what are our options as far as consolidation, as far as different options moving forward. So if we're going to continue to say, oh, well, we need to do this, but then we also give the directive multiple times, both this board and the previous board, that, okay, we're not going to touch these buildings until we figure out what's going on. I think this gets me back to my original point. We just analyze. Let's talk about it. And there's no motion. Mr. O'Donnell, I completely agree with you. I hope on the 15th you guys come forward, hopefully, that we can vote on next month's meeting, simply because we don't like adding tons of expenses to a regular board meeting without it being discussed in public. But I would like to see that move forward. I'm not stuck to ABM. I hope that there is a good alternative, whether this passes, whether this does not pass. We need to move. So that's where I just caution us that we do need to move forward. You know, I brought up the motion twice on doing a study to look at, okay, what are we going to do with this building and the other building, both of which were shot down. If that's something we'd like to revisit, I would like to do so.
I agree with you 100%, okay? And at this point, okay, recognizing that Mr. Brown and myself and maybe Mr. Knoll or whoever else can put in the time and effort to come to this board with some reasonable set of expectations for the board, let's move to take a vote on this issue.
Okay, one more thing.
George, Chad,
I would like to have, I have a few questions, like we're bringing up boilers and everything. Okay, I used to install the boilers. I'm gonna put the public at ease right now. There's three safety devices on boilers, relief valves and all that. They're gonna blow before a boiler blows. They're gonna shut down that unit before anything happens. Also, you were mentioning about leaks in the roof and all that. Okay, I could see leaks in the roof before anything happens with a boiler. The thing is, we're talking about 10-year-old air conditioner, 10-year-old boiler, 20-year, okay. I want to know, that's why I like to have Mr. Brown here at our meetings from now on, because I have a few questions. He's the manager, he should be here. Okay, we say there's a 20-year boiler in Ramsey. It's its life. Okay, is there any record of any kind that you put the main brain in the boiler maybe 5-10 years ago? That's the main source of that boiler. I mean, the outside could be 20 years old, but if the main mechanism is there pretty new, that boiler's going to last for another 20 years. I'd like to know if anybody's keeping records of the parts going into these boilers and the essential air conditions, instead of telling me it's a 20-year, hey, you put an engine in a car, you got a new car again. I just want to know, how much money's been being put into the air condition and these boilers, and how much of an upkeep they are.
I think that's a very valid point, George.
Mr. President, can we call a vote on this, please?
Yes, we can. One
okay.
Any questions that you do have that you do want to answer, please email them over. I do want to say that Bob has been here for 2 years, so I'm not sure if records exist. I know Paul can attest that we have missing financial records for certain years. So,
and for the record, too, Chad, the units weren't just looked at the receipts.
Can we take a vote, please?
So we have
no, Chad, the units were actually inspected by engineers. So the recommendations are not based on a receipt in a filing drawer. They're based on a physical inspection.
Can we, could we move to a vote?
There is a motion and there is a second and a very lengthy discussion afterwards.
Right.
That is to remove this from the agenda under board resolutions. Could we have a roll call, Bonnie, please? Yes means we're taking it off the agenda. No means we're leaving it on the agenda.
Mr. Nola.
He doesn't understand. If we were listening, right. Yes means we are taking it off. No means we're leaving it on.
But yeah, I'm leaving it on.
So that would be a vote of no.
Nope.
Okay.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Yes, take it off.
Mr. Ritter.
Yes.
Mr. Steubenbort.
No.
Mrs. Warning.
Yes.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Yes.
Mrs. Cerucci.
No.
Mr. Lapsevich.
That's a hard decision to make. Yes.
Very good. Motion passes 6-3. So that will not be on the agenda. Do we have any other resolutions presented by board members? Do we have any other resolutions by board members? Seeing none, we'll move on to comments from residents on non-agenda items. Would anyone in tonight's audience like to address the board? Seeing none, we'll move on to reports. We will start with Mrs. Crump.
No report this evening, thank you.
Very good. Mr. Schott?
Nothing further, thank you.
Very good. Mr. Chakey?
Nothing at this time.
Very good. Mr. Rossi?
Nothing at this time.
We can keep this going, this will be a record. Mr. Short?
I always have something. I've been on the sideline with this conversation with the ADM vote, and I was going to interject, however, I did not want to go down the road of Act 39 of 2010, since Mr. Schott so eloquently defined all that information. However, it's very clear that this board is united in the fact that it needs and recognizes something be done with our systems in the buildings. It is now our turn as a board to ensure that we move forward to get something done, because these buildings need work. And that should be the commitment as we move forward. And I asked everyone to be united in that as we move forward, and we have discussion on November 15th on how we steer this board in the right direction with these decisions. So I will be asking to meet with that committee prior to the committee meeting to have some discussions about how we're going to move forward and bring some information to the forefront on November 15th. Also, quick recognition, tomorrow night we've invited some PTO FTA members to the high school auditorium to preview our new website, which will be going live this Friday. Board members are invited as well at 6:30 p.m. in the LGI. That's all for tonight.
Thank you very much, Mr. Short. Mr. O'Donnell.
I have only one item, and that is to let board members know, in particular Mary Beth Cerucci, yes, and Scotty. Are you still there, Scotty?
Yes.
And Stephanie, that I hope to come to you four guys in the very near future days with a GAP committee report. As I said before, I'll share it with board members first. This will be a document, and it's almost all done. Okay, this will be a document that have already have the imprimatur, the approval of Mr. Short. Mr. Chakey's been helping me a lot. April King's been helping me a lot. Dr. Carmen Brown is helping me a lot. So we're moving to a finished product to go from the committee board members to the board as a whole, to the committee as a whole, and then back to the full board to make a decision as to whether or not they want to move forward, and that's all.
Very good. And you'll keep the board abreast of, you said you wanted to schedule a special meeting?
Yeah.
For that. Okay.
Yeah, we're going to try, like I said, to do this at just one special meeting, because many of the committee members want to present and
Very good. I just want to make sure it's open to the public. And
absolutely.
Very good.
Absolutely.
Stephanie?
I look forward to the special meeting to discuss the achievement gap committee results. And I have nothing further.
Very good, Mr. Lapsovich, or whatever you were just wearing.
Okay. Thank you. All the board for their concerns of our problems and all that, I feel we're going to iron it out, because we're a united board for one thing. We have our ups and downs. We all get together. We all come together at the end of the day. And I also want to thank Paul, Mr. Short, and Mr. Rossi, and Dennis. Their hard work they're doing, and just keep up the good work. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Mrs. Warren.
I got to talk a little bit. First off, I just want to congratulate our boys-girls volleyball team, the boys and girls soccer team. They made it to first round of playoffs, but that's where their season ended. But just congratulations to make it that far. To our football team, they will be making their first appearance in the first round of playoffs on Friday at Armstrong. 7:30 at Armstrong Field. You can get the tickets at the AD office, which will be cheaper at the AD office compared to when you get to the field. 7:30 the game starts. Also, congratulations to Mr. Helchi and his staff and the band. They took first place in their division at the past PIMS.
PIMS.
I I thought it was Pims.
Pims.
Pims. Yes. Oh, come on, give me, I'm on this, I'm on top of this one too. No, it's not that. But congratulations to all the teams and to all the students and staff for working together to get them to go. I have to bring up something. I was visiting with, after making appointments, over at University Park. Fourth grade started doing the Gator Gazette. It's fourth grade. Miss Rubino's room. It's a newspaper that these students are doing themselves. It's, they are talking all about, they have a comedy section, they have a weather section, they have a sports section, they have upcoming events, they welcome the new principal, they talked about their specials and everything that they're doing. The kids did everything on their own. This is what it's working to bring the students up to every day. Their inputs, they really had a good time. This, the teachers really were amazed at what these students were able to put out. So they were going to do it every month, but they thought it took a little bit too much out of them, out of the teachers, not the kids. So I believe they're going to do it every 2 months. But hats off to University Park. Ms. Hoffner, thank you for supporting them in these new efforts. Also, remember to vote next Tuesday. That's coming up. It's an important decision that we all need to make. Also, Veterans Day. Sincere thanks to all our veterans for all that you have done in your serve, in your service for our country. And with that, that's it.
Thank you. Very good. Mrs. Cerucci.
I have one announcement I would like to make. It's hard to believe that some of us are talking about holiday shopping, but it's right around the corner. So I have a dear friend, Penny Zeisloft, who is hosting an event called Donuts and Donations. And it is December 10th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at their home on Coleman Drive. I can give you information. But basically what you can do at this event is purchase fair trade gifts for your friends and family from 10,000 Villages, which is an organization that donates money and provides a living wage to international artisans who do things like home decor, accessories, ornaments, handbags, jewelry, coffee, chocolate, and more. And also a group called Rahab's Rope, which fights human trafficking in India. Also, at that time, if you have somebody that doesn't really need anything and you would like to make a charitable donation in their name as a gift, she will have organizations there where you can do that. Some are local, some are national, international, like World Vision, Compassion International, Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, doing Sudan Famine Relief, and Pitcairn Incorporated and Pitcairn, as well as the Pitcairn Food Pantry. So if anyone is looking for a unique shopping event, please get a hold of Penny if you know her, or feel free to reach out to me for donuts and donations. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Mary Beth. Mr. Ritter.
Thank you for bringing that up, because I got that email this afternoon. I already signed up to go, so I am going to help support, especially the folks in Pitcairn. And number two is shout out to Miko. You've been able to put in, the board meetings out on the local cable TV in a looping fashion. I got to watch myself speak twice, you know, uninterrupted in my house, you know. I'm the boss in my house, and the reason I know that is because my wife says so. So I got to speak number. And the last thing, of course, is chocolate chip cookies. This is a throwdown to Alex Portis and any other kids out there that want to, you know, bake something. Bring them here. I say, bring them here. Hand them out, and we'll, you know, this board will test out your products. Great. That's my report.
It's a big time throwdown.
Thank you.
I now have an excuse the way I look. Mr. Williams, are you still with us?
Yeah, no report, Chad.
No report, thank you. Mr. Nola.
All right, yeah, a couple real quick things, I hope. New artwork, everybody. take a look. Yeah. Gateway Middle School artwork, looks good. Hope the cameras can get a little picture of that. It's always nice to see, and I never want to miss that. That is one of the highlights of my board times, coming to boards. All right, so two more things, or maybe three, I guess. I believe that, you know, I think that we've been hearing a lot recently about, you know, the board, like, you know, it seems like we're bickering. I just believe that everybody has, you know, the entire district's best interest at heart, and I think that that's why it's going that way. I, and that's, it's healthy and it's fine, I think, as long as we, you know, at the end of the day, can come together and, you know, as Mr. O'Donnell says, break bread or have a soda or whatever you told me one time. I can't remember what it was. So that's one thing. But I just wanted to say something about, I'm a very positive person. And I'm you know, and I think, you know, some people are a little bit more negative than I, but I want to try to get you to the positive side. I think, you know, we should never, and I always want to say that the board should be the first to incorporate this, and then it should go down through the administration and the principals and the teachers. Hey, you know, we shouldn't be blaming people or calling them out or you know, out to get anybody. We should be trying to build people up. We should be trying to partner with them, help them.
Promote excellence.
And you know, we need to get the most potential out of everybody and everything that we have here. Because, and that's how we end up with the scores that we do. And that's the things, and we do that on a consistent basis, I think. But I think that I want to challenge us to even step up and do it more. I want us to build everybody up. I want us to partner with everybody and help them along the way. And I do just have one question, and I hope it doesn't lead to a long thing, but this week we got the, I got the survey questions, I guess. I guess we got the survey questions for the uniforms. I just want to, I don't want to be critical, but I do want to say, I think we got two versions of it. I think we should just be directed to the point and ask the questions that we want to ask. We shouldn't try to lead people one way, the other, this way, that way. Just ask them the questions we want to know. Just ask them what we think we want to know in the survey questions. Some of them I was reading, and I think that they were kind of trying to steer people a certain way. And I'm not big on doing that. I think we should, that's the whole idea of the survey. Hear what the people want to say. Don't try to push them in a certain direction. That's just my take on it. And that's it.
Thank you. Right. Excuse me. Is that all, Neil?
Yes.
There wasn't something else you wanted to mention?
Oh, yeah. And I agreed with everybody in the room, especially Steve.
Thank you.
Multiple times.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Neil. Mine will be pretty brief. I want to say a huge thank you again to Anthony Scalise, one of our school officers who performed the Heimlich maneuver. I know Chris and his family are very thankful for that, and I believe everyone on the board and everyone in Gateway School District is very happy with the outcome there. So thank you very much to him. And as he had said, you know, all of our guys are doing a great job. You know, under the supervision of Brian, I think they're doing a great job in the situation that they're in. I believe Val had mentioned it, but I will just re-mention it. Remember that November 8th, next Tuesday, is election day, so please stop out to the polls and vote. Lastly, just to give you guys a quick update, I know we touched on briefly, the policy committee got together, went over the 700 policies. We will try sometime at either the end of this month or the beginning of next month to go through the 800s. 700s, there wasn't a lot, just a few minor changes. And did also want to say that the Narcan policy, was that one on there?
No.
I did not see it. So the Narcan policy, I will email out to everyone, and if we could also post that on Board Doc so it is visible, and we can just, I guess, put that on 30-day display on the 15th.
Do we need a motion on that?
So moved.
Second.
A motion, is that a motion to place it on 30 days?
Yes.
Second.
There's a motion, second. All in favor of placing the policy on 30-day display, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, that is now on 30-day display. Thank you. Yes, and make sure it's posted so that board, the public, again, you'll have 30 days to review that and bring forth any comments or questions.
Tomorrow.
Okay.
So good job with that. We have a few other policies to go over. Like I said, we'll try to schedule the 800s here later this month or next month. Other than that, I guess just to reiterate a point that multiple people have made tonight, I really do think that everyone up here has, you know, what's best for the students and the teachers and the Gateway community as a whole at heart. I think we have different ideas and paths to get there, but I think it's healthy. I don't think we've had any disrespectful conversations as of yet. I don't think we've had any anything like that. So I do want to thank everyone on the board for having the dialogue, being open, allowing things to progress, and I am very excited to see what Billings and Groton comes up with, because we do need to move on certain things again sooner rather than later. So with that,
I'd like to make a motion for executive session on personnel and possible litigation after the meeting.
I have a motion.
Second.
We have a second. All in favor of going into executive session?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, we'll now go into executive session. What's that?
Can you say that we're basically just going to come out in the journal?
Oh, that's what I want to ask.
Billings and Grounds meeting on the 15th, what time?
It's 5:00.
5:00.
On the 15th, that's before the regular school board meeting.
For the press, there's not going to be any motions made after.
This is it. We're going to just come out and adjourn.
Could we just stay right here if they leave?
Yeah, if everyone's fine with
it. I mean, unless.
Yeah, we can take a quick 2-minute recess if anyone wants to stay in the mood. Sheila, thanks for coming.
So,
you're very welcome.
So,
good seeing you again. Yeah, I've been.
Good. How's Joe? You like Joe?
Thank you. You're very welcome.
Yeah, let me know.
All right, man.
I appreciate it.
Good seeing you again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Samson, how did you get in touch with Brittany?
We're hanging with her. Thanks, Brittany.
Is there an electronic copy that I can get from Ross?
Yeah, Brittany's awesome. She was she graduated with my brother. And then her and I went to Duquesne.
Okay,
I was
a
bit with her sister.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she was behind me.
Yeah. Awesome family. I know the dad well. It's good family.
So you can sign this one as well. I don't have to have dad sign, right? It's just whoever's signing.